And it gambled two ways. A, you don't even know the record's going to sell, because the record company like Virgin had one hit, Tubular Bells, that was it. They were nothing. I mean, now, yeah, that huge corporation and everything has gone smoothly. Well, if I could see the future, you know, I wouldn't need to manage a band, really, would I?
I was driving home when I thought I heard somebody on the radio say, "Life is a minestrone." I don't think they had said that, but it sounded like that. And I thought, well, there's a philosophy. I'm leaving on the tower of fever, had a night full of the tower in France. And if life is a minestrone, to me, I hate cold food. I can't eat cold food. So death is a cold lasagna to me. And Eric and I had our turn at writing together. We came up with that bit of nonsense, you know. And that was the first track, because the record company wanted to go with something safe with this new album, this new act that they had. And it seemed like a more obviously commercial song than Australia.
I think by the time we got into original soundtrack, we'd shown that our way of doing things could be successful. So we were left alone to crack on with things. And we were trying a bit harder to push our boundaries in different ways.
There was always still this desire to go one better with a song and do something different with it. Hence, I'm Not in Love. The way that song developed, which, looking back on it, it was astounding. We ever released it, we ever got it out, we ever got it finished.
The title was Eric's. We've been discussing writing a love song, but I don't think we wanted to write a cliche. And I'm Not in Love was the perfect title.
What? A cliche? No, it can't be. Gosh, they must be out of their heads. Oh, come on. They must have been able to get serious. What on earth are you talking about?
Who'd you talking about?
I'll tell you what. It should have been a heartbreaking ballad all about a man in distress missing his first wife he was in love with from the very start. Until the day she passed away.
I wrote all the words, completely. And I took it into the studio, and Graham Gouldman said, "Yeah, I'll finish it with you. I think there's a great idea there." So we sat down, we completed it. Graham put some lovely chords into it. And we went in the studio to record it as a bossa nova. Congos and things and bongos.
When we heard it back, everyone was underwhelmed, I think's the best word. And it was, nobody had the real enthusiasm to carry on with it. It sounded so underwhelming.
I never like the bossa nova version of I'm Not in Love, so I changed it to a soul ballad remake of that song, covered by soul singer and backup vocalist Mr. Dennis Englewood from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Yeah, I hated it. I hated it. Oh, sure, I'll say I didn't like it particularly. I didn't get it particularly. There was something in there. And we all recognised that there was something in there, but that treatment didn't really bring it to life. And we weren't really sure what we could do with it. I think I said at the time, well, why don't we do it with voices, no instruments, just all a tsunami of voices, wash of voices. Probably out of desperation, really, trying to come up with something to make this thing come to life.
The biggest mistake was in 1975. They did a poor job on their original recording of that song when they created too many layers of synth voices messing up the real thing. They made their original music more tarnished without polishing it up. The problem was about 10cc, they could have done a better job rather than leaving it in a mess like that. sad that there was nothing that they could do about it. So terrible. Shame that I feel sorry for them.
And I said, what do you mean a cappella? You know, we all sing without a backing. He said, no, the backing track. Let's do the whole backing track with voices, like a massive choir, the biggest choir you can imagine. I said, great. How do we do it? How do we do that? There's only four of us. And Lol said, tape loops. I said, great. All right, let's do it. And we spent 3 weeks recording three of them in the studio, Kevin, Lol and Graham, singing as long as they could hold their breath. Then they did that 16 times on the 16 track machine, copied all that across to a stereo machine, and we had 13 notes to choose from, a chromatic scale with a top C and a bottom C, and 624 voices were there at our disposal. I then played them back through the 16 track machine, through the control desk, and I gave each of us a set of three faders to go up and down when the chords were changing for I'm Not in Love, and the little
All of us worked the desk and played it like a keyboard, and when we had all the notes playing together, you got that lovely abstract because it's a mass of harmonics all bleeding together. So we kept them, all of the notes, in to a certain degree with a piece of masking tape so that the faders were all at a certain level. And that's what made that in-tune harmonic sound, but with an extra something. And it made something really special.
Originally, I think we were going to do it with just voices, nothing else. So we recorded a rhythm track, which we thought was going to be a temporary. And I think the idea was that we'd sing to that and do all the vocals, then we'd take that off and we'd be left with this song recorded with just the choir and the vocals. But there was something about it, there was magic about it. And of course, once we'd put the other voices on, we didn't want to touch anything, we didn't want to take it out.
I'm not in love, so don't forget it. It's just a silly phase I'm going through.
I did the lead vocal again, but the guy vocal I'd done was so good, we kept it. So it was basically finished. And then you come to the Godley and Cream moment again. What should we do next? Just as we said that, the secretary at the studio, Kathy Redfern, popped her head round the door. She said, Eric, there's a phone call for you.
And then they said, that's it. So I immediately turned round and ran back to the reception area. I thought, no way. And Lol came after me, actually, and took me in and said, we want you to do something for us. All the time I'm thinking, no, I can't sing, I can't do this. And I remember Kev came in with me into the studio and they said, you've just got to whisper. Be quiet, big boys don't cry.
Are you crazy? Are you out of your mind?
This doesn't make any sense.
I never like Kathy Redfern's annoying be quiet, big boys don't cry part in the middle because it's a lot too daft for me. See what it did? It messed up the song, and I don't like it. I hate the preposterous loop that kept repeating her last dim-witted, bashful spoken line, big boys don't cry for no reason at all. 'Cause every time I hear it, it makes me want to close my ears. That's what also destroyed up in the middle of the song, I'm Not in Love, and I don't like it either. I don't understand why, in the name of heaven, it made that song go off. I don't trust her, because in mid-song, she didn't face the facts. First, Eric Stewart sang a meaningful ballad, I'm Not in Love, that touched my heart and soul, plus a sister's heart and a brother's soul. than a dimwit with the worst annoying whispering voice named Kathy Redfern spoiled up the midsection of that song, telling him to be quiet, which I know it's not nice, and started to assume that big boys don't cry, which I know is untrue. That's not how the song was meant to be. It's supposed to be a pop ballad filled with meaning. The well-sung ballad part itself, I'm not in love, I always appreciate listening to. Because every time I listen to it, it makes me want to sing. So I like the serious ballad part done by Eric Stewart entitled I'm Not In Love better than Kathy's annoying rubbish in the middle. I hate Kathy Redfern because she's such a dimwit. That's why she can't sing.
Another fake!
So he made the whole audience boo her out.
Boo-hoo-hoo.
Furthermore, she's not a singer of songs, so I'm going to count her out. Since I'm not a big fan of Kathy Redfern, I changed it to a scene from One Day at a Time with Anne Romano acting like she's not in love with her hubby anymore since she slapped her son Alex in the face. Then I added a scene from Be My Valentine, Charlie Brown, where Lucy asked Schroeder if he wanted to suffer the tortures of a memory of a lost love. And another scene, one more time from One Day at a Time, where Anne Romano acts like she's not in love with her husband anymore since she slapped her daughter, Julie, in the face. Those are the kinds of the relevant TV scenes from those TV shows that match the song that Eric was singing. So here they are.
I hate you!
Ow,
I hate you!
Alex!
I hate you! And if you were such a great mother, how come your kids dropped out of school and ran away, huh?
Alex!
Oh, hey!
Ooh. Ooh, you had a long time with me. Ooh, you had a long time.
In those days, we tried everything. If someone had an idea, it got tried. It didn't always work, but I think this is one of those sessions where whatever you added to it after a certain point, it just kept on getting better. You know, astonishing.
Are you sure you want to suffer the tortures of a memory of a lost love? Do you know the tortures of the memory of a lost love? It's awful! It will haunt you night and day! You'll wake up at night screaming! You can't eat! You can't sleep! You'll hate yourself and the world and everybody in it! Oh! Are you sure you want to risk losing me?
If you have to prove your manhood, get somebody your own age!
Shut up!
Oh, what's the matter with you? What's the matter with you, doctor? Ever try getting your kicks with a woman?
Shut up, Mom!
How about taking me on, or is that too frightening for you?
You lonely, Mom! You want him!
Telling someone to be quiet mid-song is not a great idea, which is not suitable for families and children who are wholesome. I find her middle part ill-bred, so I had to take down her negative interjection, which is not right for me. I was denied to say be quiet in the middle of Dennis's soul ballad remake of the 10cc song I'm Not In Love with a lot of real instruments playing, and now I still am, because I really do believe that it's very impolite to most everyone like me who are nice to each other. I also was denied to assume that all big boys don't cry, in that same soul ballad version done by that same man as the Ivory King of Soul from the mid-1980s.